Radio Krishna presents stories about Lord Krishna from the book Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Derived from the Vedic scripture, the Srimad Bhagavatam, they were written in Sanskrit several thousand years ago by Srila Dvaipayana Vyasadeva and were translated into English by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, founder and spiritual guide of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. Your narrator is Amal Bhakta. And now, today's episode is entitled, The Appearance of Lord Krishna. Once the world was overburdened by the unnecessary defense forces of different kings, who were actually demons, but were posing themselves as the royal order. At that time, the whole world became perturbed. So the predominating deity of the planet Earth, known as Bhumi, went to see Lord Brahma, the creator of the universe. Bhumi assumed the form of a cow, presented herself before Lord Brahma with tears in her eyes, and related to him the calamities of the earth. After hearing of them, Lord Brahma became much aggrieved, so he, along with Bhumi and all the other demigods, journeyed to the spiritual planet of Shvetadvip, where the Supreme Lord Vishnu resides. There, on the shore of the ocean of milk, Lord Brahma began to pacify Lord Vishnu with prayers. Next, he sat in meditation for a while, received a message in his heart from Lord Vishnu, and then broadcast it to the demigods. The message was as follows. I, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, will appear on earth very soon, along with my supreme powerful potencies. And as long as I remain to execute my mission of annihilating the demons and establishing the devotees, the demigods should also remain there to assist me. They should all immediately take birth in the family of the Yadu dynasty, wherein I will also appear in due course of time. After instructing and pacifying Bhumi and all the demigods with sweet words, Lord Brahma departed for his own planet, Brahmaloka. The leader of the Yadu dynasty, King Shurasena, was ruling over the district known as Mathura. On account of the rule of King Shurasena, Mathura became the capital city of all the Yadu dynasty kings, who were very pious people. Once upon a time, Vasudeva, the son of Shurasena, just after marrying Devaki, was going home on his chariot with his newly wedded wife. At that time, Kamsa, the son of King Ugrasena, in order to please his sister Devaki, had voluntarily taken the reins of the horses of Vasudeva's chariot and was driving. According to the custom of Vedic civilization, when a girl is married, the brother takes the sister and brother-in-law to their home. Because the newly married bride may feel too much grief over the separation from her father's family, the brother goes with her until she reaches her father-in-law's house. The full dowry contributed by Devaki's father was as follows. 400 elephants, fully decorated with golden garlands, 15,000 decorated horses, and 1,800 chariots. He also arranged for 200 beautiful maidservants to follow his daughter. While the bride and bridegroom were riding on the chariot, musicians were playing jubilantly on conch shells, bugles, drums, and kettle drums to mark the auspicious occasion. The procession was passing very pleasingly, when suddenly from the sky, a miraculous voice boomed out. Kamsa, you are such a fool. You are driving the chariot of your sister and your brother-in-law, but you do not know that the eighth child of this sister will kill you. After hearing the prophecy from the sky, Kamsa, because he was very demoniac, immediately caught hold of Devaki's hair and was just about to kill her with his sword. But Vasudeva, astonished, then attempted to pacify his cruel, shameless brother-in-law and said, "My dear Kamsa, you are the most famous king of the Bhoja dynasty, and people know that you are the greatest warrior and a valiant king. How is it that you are so infuriated that you are prepared to kill a woman who is your own sister at this auspicious time of her marriage? Why are you so much afraid of death? From the very day you took your birth, you began to die. And when you do die, you will receive, by the arrangement of material nature, another body. Therefore, having nothing really to fear, please do not be overwhelmed by the dictation of your mind and body." But Kamsa was not at all pacified. So Vasudeva tried another tack. "My dear brother-in-law, please consider that you have no danger from your sister. The danger is to come from the sons of your sister who are not present now. And who knows, there may or may not be sons in the future. Considering all this, you are safe for the present. But if Devaki does give birth to sons, I promise that I shall present all of them to you for necessary action." Kamsa knew the value of Vasudeva's word of honor and was convinced by his argument. So, for the time being, he desisted from killing his sister. Vasudeva was very relieved and, after praising Kamsa's decision, returned with Devaki to his home. When the first son was born, Vasudeva immediately brought the child before Kamsa. Kamsa was pleased and surprised to see Vasudeva keeping his promise. Feeling somewhat compassionate, he said, "My dear Vasudeva, you need not give this child to me, for it is your eighth child that is supposed to kill me. You can take him back." When Vasudeva was returning home with his firstborn child, he was pleased by Kamsa's behavior, but he knew that Kamsa, who lacked self-control, could change his mind at any moment. At that time, the great sage Narada visited Kamsa, and he was informed about Kamsa returning Vasudeva's firstborn child. He therefore informed Kamsa that personalities like Nanda Maharaj and all the cowherd men and girls, and the wives of the cowherd men in Vrindavan, as well as Vasudeva, his father Shurasena, and all his relatives born in the family of Vrishni of the Yadu dynasty, were preparing for the appearance of the Lord. Narada warned Kamsa to be careful of the friends and the well-wishers in those families, as well as of the demigods who had taken birth in them. So Kamsa at once became alert. He understood that since the demigods had already taken birth, Lord Vishnu or Krishna must be coming soon. Therefore, he at once arrested both Devaki and Vasudeva and shackled them behind prison bars. Within the prison, Devaki gave birth to a male child year after year, and Kamsa, thinking each of the babies to be the incarnation of Vishnu, killed each one of them. Though he was particularly afraid of the eighth child, after the visit of Narada, he came to the conclusion that any of the children might be Krishna. Therefore, he felt it safer to kill all the babies. He further imprisoned his father Ugrasena because he was the chief king among the Yadu, Bhoja, and Andika dynasties. And Kamsa also occupied the kingdom of Shurasena, Vasudeva's father. Thus he declared himself the king of all these places. Kamsa made alliances with other demoniac kings until he became the strongest of leaders. Then he began to behave most hatefully toward the Yadu dynasty in which Krishna was soon to take birth. When Devaki became pregnant for the seventh time, a plenary expansion of Krishna, known as Anantashesha, appeared within her womb. At that time, Krishna ordered his principal potency, Yogamaya, to take birth in the village of Vrindavan, which was near Mathura. There, Rohini, one of the wives of Vasudeva, was residing at the house of Nanda and Yashoda. Not only Rohini, but many others of the Yadu dynasty were scattered all over the country due to their fear of Kamsa's atrocities. Some of them were even living in mountain caves. The Lord then said to Yogamaya, "My plenary expansion, Anantashesha, is within the womb of Devaki. He is the source of all spiritual power and the original spiritual master, and shall be known as Balaram. You can arrange for the transfer of Anantashesha from the womb of Devaki to the womb of Rohini. After this arrangement, I am personally going to appear in the womb of Devaki with my full potencies as her son, and you will appear as the daughter of Nanda and Yashoda in Vrindavan." After Anantashesha was transferred from Devaki's womb to Rohini's, people believed that Devaki's seventh pregnancy was a miscarriage. Thereafter, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, entered the heart of Vasudeva. He then transferred himself to the heart of Devaki, and from there entered her womb. It was by immaculate conception, that is, without the use of seminal discharge, that the Lord chose to appear in Devaki's womb. When Kamsa looked at his sister, he saw her glowing, transcendental beauty, and at once concluded that the Supreme Personality of Godhead had taken shelter in her womb. Kamsa then began to brood. What is to be done with Devaki? Surely she has Vishnu or Krishna within her womb. So it is certain that Vishnu has come to kill me. If I kill Devaki at the present moment, Vishnu will enforce his supreme will more vehemently. Besides, killing her would be a most abominable act and would spoil my reputation. For Devaki is a woman. She is under my shelter, and she is pregnant. Moreover, I would lose the results of my pious activity and the normal duration of my life. People would curse me. I might even go to the darkest region of hell. Kamsa thus meditated on all the pros and cons of killing Devaki. He finally decided not to kill her, but to wait for her child to be born, and then kill him. At this time, Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, accompanied by great sages like Narada and followed by many other demigods, invisibly appeared in the house of Kamsa. They began to pray for and worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead. After doing so, the demigods, with Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva in front of them, returned to their heavenly abodes. When it was time for the Lord to appear, the constellations in the sky became very auspicious. At that time, in all directions, there was an atmosphere of peace and prosperity. Flowers bloomed, rivers flowed, birds sang, peacocks danced, and the wind blew pleasantly. The celestials sang, danced, and offered prayers to the Lord. The sages and demigods showered flowers from the sky. The waves at the seashore were mild, and the clouds rumbled delightfully. Then Lord Vishnu, who resides in the heart of every living being, took birth in the darkness of night before Devaki, like the full moon rising on the eastern horizon. It was obvious that the effulgent baby was none other than Lord Vishnu, for he had four hands, each of which held a conch shell, a club, a disc, and a lotus flower. His chest was decorated with the mark of Sri Vatsa, or a curl of hair. He wore a jeweled necklace of Kaustubha stone, and he was clothed in yellow silk. He looked dazzling like a bright blackish cloud. He also wore a helmet inlaid with a Vaidurya stone, sported valuable bracelets, earrings, and other similar ornaments all over his body, and had an abundance of hair on his head. Vasudeva was struck with wonder. As he looked at his newborn baby, he was so happy that, in celebration, he mentally gave away thousands of cows in charity to the Brahmins. Then he bowed down with folded hands and began to offer the Lord heartfelt prayers. At that time, Vasudeva was in a transcendental state, and he became completely free from all fear of Kamsa. After Vasudeva finished his prayers, Devaki offered hers. She was very frightened because of her brother's atrocities, so she begged, "My Lord, please save me from the cruel hands of Kamsa, for you are always ready to give protection to your servitors. My only cause of fear for my brother Kamsa is due to your appearance. Kamsa may not know that you are already born. Therefore, I entreat you to conceal your four-armed form so that you will not be easily recognizable, and then perhaps I can hide you somewhere from Kamsa." But Krishna replied, "I appeared in this Vishnu form just to convince you that I, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, have again taken birth. I could have appeared just like an ordinary child, but then you may have doubted who I really am. I know you are very concerned about me and afraid of Kamsa, and to allay those fears, here is what is to be done. Father, I want you to take me to Gokula immediately. There you will find that Yashoda has just given birth to a daughter. You will replace her daughter with me, and then bring her back here." Having spoken thus, the Lord transformed himself into an ordinary two-armed child and remained silent. By the magical influence of Yashoda's newborn daughter, who was none other than Yogamaya, Krishna's internal potency, all the residents of Kamsa's palace, especially the gatekeepers, were overwhelmed with deep sleep. And all the palace doors, which were locked and shackled with chains, suddenly opened. The night was very dark, but as soon as Vasudeva took Krishna and went out, he could see everything, just as in the sunlight, as a result of Krishna's glaring effulgence. At the same time, there was thunder in the sky and severe rainfall. While Vasudeva was carrying his son through the falling rain, Ananda Shesha appeared there in the shape of a serpent and spread his hood over the head of Vasudeva like an umbrella so that he would not be hampered by the rainfall. When Vasudeva reached the bank of the Yamuna River, he saw that the water was roaring with waves and that the whole span was full of foam. Still, in that furious feature, the river gave passage to Vasudeva, and he crossed it easily. On the other side, he went to the home of Nanda Maharaj, situated in Gokula, where he saw that all the cowherd men were fast asleep. He silently entered the house without difficulty and exchanged his son for Yashoda's newborn girl. Then he recrossed the river, returned to the prison, and closed all the doors and gates. Next, he silently placed the baby girl on Devaki's lap and reclamped the shackles on himself so that Kamsa could not understand what had happened. In Gokula, when Yashoda had given birth, she was so tired from the labor of delivery that she fell fast asleep. And when she awoke, she could not remember whether she had given birth to a male or a female child. After Vasudeva re-entered his cell, the gatekeepers awoke and heard the newborn child crying. They immediately hastened to Kamsa's bedroom and informed him of it. Kamsa jumped out of his bed and exclaimed, "Now, the cruel death of my life has been born." He became perplexed. His hair stood on end, and he hurried to the cell where Krishna had been born. Devaki, on seeing Kamsa approaching, meekly prayed to him, "My dear brother, my child is a female. Please do not kill her. When she is of age, I promise to give her to your son as a wife. According to the omen, you are not to be killed by a female, but by a male." Nonetheless, Kamsa was so cruel that he did not listen to Devaki's prayers. Instead, to rebuke her, he forcibly grabbed the newborn child and was just about to mercilessly dash her onto the stone. However, the child, Yogamaya, having miraculous powers, flew out of his hands and up into the air and mystically hovered there as the goddess Durga. She was decorated with a gorgeous dress, flower garlands and ornaments, and in each of her eight hands she held a bow, a lance, arrows, a sword, a conch shell, a disc, a club, and a shield. Seeing the glorious child, all the demigods appeared there, presented her with gifts, and offered their respective prayers. Then the goddess said to Kamsa, "You rascal, how can you kill me? But the child who will kill you has already been born before me, somewhere within this world. So don't be so cruel to your poor sister." Kamsa then became overwhelmed with fear. Out of pity and guilt, he unshackled and freed Vasudeva and Devaki. Then he apologized very politely and effusively for his past atrocities against their newborn children. When Devaki and Vasudeva saw Kamsa so repentant, they became pacified. Vasudeva then spoke to him in a very forgiving and philosophical manner. Then Kamsa became exceedingly pleased, and his feeling of guilt for having killed his nephews subsided. With the permission of Devaki and Vasudeva, he returned to his chambers with a relieved mind. Thus ends the story of the glorious birth or appearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna, who entered this world to annihilate the demons, to save the pious, to reestablish the principles of religion, and to enact loving pastimes with his intimate devotees. All glories to Lord Krishna. All glories to his devotees. All glories to the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, in which Lord Krishna has mercifully appeared to bless everyone and anyone who chants it or hears it. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. This story was entitled The Appearance of Lord Krishna and was presented by Radio Krishna at the KHQN studios in Los Angeles, California. It was derived from the book Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, written by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, founder and spiritual guide of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, and was adapted for radio by Amal Bhakta Das, your narrator. The engineering and musical selections were under the direction of Vaibhavi Devi Dasi.